Hello everybody and welcome to this week's episode of Kim's Upholstery Live, brought to you by Kim's Upholstery. We are back this week working on our fancy club chair that we're calling it. This is episode number, or part number 8 of this project that we've started together. We started way back in the teardown, if you remember that part, and this was a white chair. It wasn't very attractive at that point in time, but I'm thinking it looks pretty fabulous. I don't know what you guys think, but I'm really liking these combinations together. And this week we will be putting the diamond fabric that I got from Spoonflower onto the outside back of our chair. So what I've done is I've gone ahead, I think last week we finished up attaching the contrast banding strip that's around, let me turn this so you guys can see it better. It's around the top edge. So I've gone ahead and added the cording on, which I mentioned I was going to do just to save time. And I put the CurveEase on the two outside arm, outside wing areas, and we'll be attaching the CurveEase to the top of the outside back together here this afternoon. So as you come in, go ahead and say hello. Let us know where you're viewing from. We always love to see where everybody's coming from to watch us on our live. And as always, we ask if you would please share this with your followers out there on Facebook and on YouTube. You can share it with social media as well. Now, for those of you on YouTube, if you're not subscribed to our channel at this point, we would love it if you'd go ahead and hit that subscribe button and then click on that bell icon that shows up so that you get notified every time we put content out on YouTube or when we go live on YouTube. So let's get started with our chair. So what I was just doing is I've got a few areas left to put staples into the CurveEase. So I get the CurveEase attached all the way up the front perimeter of the arm, across the top, and up into the wing section. Because this is going to be one piece of fabric that will do the outside arm and the outside wing, then a separate piece for the outside back, and you know, another piece for the other outside arm and outside wing. So I've got just a little bit of stapling here that I have left to do. Let me get those in there. And if you've ever worked with CurveEase, you may have a love-hate relationship with it. But CurveEase, I just love CurveEase. I think it's the greatest invention since, I don't know what, peanut butter maybe. Because I love peanut butter. But it is just, it makes it a really nice, crisp, clean way to finish up your outsides. Sometimes you might have a fabric that you don't want to use CurveEase with if the fabric is more delicate or if the fabric is I'll think of it in a minute. But a fabric that really frays a lot, you might not want to use CurveEase. You might have to hand stitch something. But anytime you have a curved area on a piece of furniture and you don't want to hand stitch, CurveEase is the way to go. Hey, Susan from Annapolis and June from Kentucky and Mary is here from Stafford, Virginia and Sylvia from West Maryland and Joan from South Dakota. Anne is here from Ohio. She's loving the chair. Hello, Michelle from the UK. And Anne says hello and hello, Joanne from Florida. So thank you everybody for hopping in today to join us for this episode of Kim's Upholstery Live over there on Facebook. Let's see, YouTube's not getting very active yet, but it'll catch up with you guys. So I think I've got, I started pressing that part closed already. Just make sure before I get too distracted. Yep, there's one hole that I didn't get a staple in. So how many of you have used CurveEase? And do you love it or hate it or still struggling trying to get it right? This staple didn't go all the way in, so I'm gonna tap it in with a hammer. One leg stayed up just a little bit. Now when you put your CurveEase in, as long as you get your positioning right, up by, behind your cording, and then you close it part way, when you start to put the pieces of fabric on using the CurveEase, it usually goes pretty easily. Because I say that, I probably jinxed myself though, because that's, you know, that's how things go. So what I'm doing right now is just pressing the rest of these partway closed. Now, typically when you upholster a piece of furniture, or when I upholster a piece of furniture, I usually put the outside wings, outside arms on before I put on the outside back. But in our case here today, because I want to make sure my diamond patterns match as nicely as they can down the sides. Now, because of the angle of the chair, they're not going to be dead on everywhere because you've got a curve going this way and then the back tapers down this way as well. So I'm actually going to start getting the back attached a little bit, leave the sides open, and then be able to match my outside arms to that. And then we'll come back and finish off the back later. So we're going to do it in a little bit different order than I typically do. And like I said, it's because I want to have a deliberate match for that outside area. Now let's go ahead and get our CurveEase attached to our outside back. You can see I stopped the CurveEase for the outside wings right at the corner. is there's very little space where the two overlap right here in this section. When you come down further, you know, your outside wing area comes over more into the back. But up here, they're sharing about the same inch and a half here. So I just stopped the CurveEase right there, and then I'm gonna start this CurveEase in a little bit from the end for our outside back. And when you're using your CurveEase, you do want one staple leg in every single hole. And it takes practice to get so you can do it smoothly. Where's my upright post? There we go. And it also pinches your finger, so beware. I usually draw blood at least once or twice using CurveEase. And I didn't bring the band-aids out here, which I probably should have, but we got the cameraman to go chase them down if we need them. So when you're attaching your CurveEase, you really have to become one with your gun and know where the staples come out of the front end of your gun so that you can hit these the way you need to. And I really do like the way these little bow ties that I'm calling them turned out on the black and white on the edge there. Go get my aviation snips and we will cut this down. Let's see where I ended it on this side right there. So it goes straight up. Now if you end up with any sharp points, which I should check before I put those away, on your CurveEase, go ahead and snip them off or file them down if you need to, because you don't want any sharp areas that are going to dig into your fabric. That usually only happens at the very ends there where you trim it off. It's the rest of the way around, it's usually fine. Let's get this out of here before I lay my chair down on top of it. I'm not gonna lay it down yet, but we will be in a minute, so. Right, you can also use a wooden mallet to push these down partway closed. Probably could use a rubber mallet as well, but you just want to make sure when you use a mallet that you don't completely bend the CurveEase all the way up and distort the shape. All right, there we go, partway closed. And now, let me move stuff out of the way and I'm going to lay it on the front. We're going to put some cotton on our outside back. Out of my way. Let's see, I think I can do this by myself. We'll see if I can. Actually, Bill, why don't you come help me so I don't drop it on the floor, just to be safe.
What are we doing again?
Laying it on its knees.
It's kind of wrong for that.
Thank you.
We could go back this way more.
Okay. Thanks. I'll raise it up and spin it around. Get my leg work out on my pedestal. That's as high as it goes. All right, so now what I'm going to do is put a piece of cotton on here and then we'll put our outside fabric on the back. Again, we're not going to do it completely at this point. See, that's a lot longer than this is wide, so we're gonna have waste here, but that's just the way it goes. Upholstery has a lot of waste in it, and I think that's one of the hardest things for people to get used to when they're just getting into doing upholstery projects, especially if you came into this from being like a quilter or something. As quilters, you go, you know, you save every scrap because you use a lot of those, but with upholstery, there's a lot of stuff you throw away.
Well, it's not really waste. I mean, we don't throw it away. You use a lot of the small pieces, and we also give away a lot of fabric that people use for other projects. So it really doesn't go to waste.
I guess it doesn't go to waste, technically. Yeah. Yes, this is true. Good point. Yeah, we have craftspeople in the area that I am constantly calling and saying, hey, I got another bag of fabric scraps, or hey, I got some Dacron pieces, and they'll come and pick them up. So it's good to find the local artists in your area so you're not throwing all that stuff away. Put that over, and you saw I split the cotton in half because I don't want my padding on the outsides to be too thick. So let's go get a few staples in the top. And you know, I'm just gonna turn this baby this way. That way I don't tangle my hose this week, maybe. Babe. Whoops. Okay, let's hold the gun the other way and not hit our fingers. What did that go into? I stapled it in the wrong place. I have to pull that. So now I'm just going to tear the cotton back. I'm feeling that upright post because I don't want any padding on there. Get all that torn back. Now this stuff, I do save the pieces of cotton and I put them in a bag and hang on to them. And a lot of times I'll use the scraps in different upholstery projects. So let's see, we've got Katrina on YouTube and Carlin. Thank you for joining us today. And Carlin is from Columbus, Ohio, and I think Katrina said Alabama. Back a little bit too far right there, but we can squeak that out, make that work. Everything feels good. Get the excess off the bottom. All right, now I have, if I didn't cover it up on myself, I have made a mark. What I did when I was cutting out my fabric is I figured out where I wanted my repeats to hit, and I'm thinking that right here in this area underneath the arms is going to make the most sense for it to try to line up there. So I've made myself a registration mark so that I know what I want to land in those areas, and keeping our fingers crossed that this all works out the way I've got it planned out in my head. Let's see, outside back fabric is right here. I'll just put this over there so I can sit down in a second. And I did leave the white selvage on here, which will get cut off. And I also marked the tops of my fabric so that I know everything's going in the same direction. I just get in the habit of doing that in case I was working with a fabric with a nap, like the front of the chair. Now let's see, my registration mark is there. Here, so I gotta come this way. Okay, because my plan was for the registration mark was the top of a black diamond, so for the row. I don't know where it'll land specifically in the black diamond as far as that spot, but let's see, where is it? We're here. We get a couple staples at the bottom and see if I got this straight. Ooh, I think we do. Just double check. It's about right there. I think it's gonna go that way here. Should be able to tell by the diamonds at the bottom, actually. So let me actually lower this a little bit so that I can get this bottom part attached, just because I want to make sure I have a proper view of it so that I know I'm getting everything as straight as I possibly can. I'm always flipping the chair from one direction to the other when I'm upholstering. It's never in the same position all the time. Want to make sure it's comfortable on your back for working. Okay, it's going to come this way. And I know you can't see my little registration marks, but I think that's it. Oh, and you know what I didn't check was left to right for the center of the top. I wanted to do that before I get going here. So yeah, so I need to squeak this come towards me. I think my thought was having a white diamond land right underneath that little black bow tie, so the top of a white diamond. Let me just kind of fold the fabric here, so you're gonna have to see me bent over just to see what that looks like. White or black? Eeny, meeny, miny, mo. If I do black, then it's a half a black. I think I like the white better. Okay, decision made. Let's keep that right there. So this white diamond is the center. Now, to make sure I'm precise, I'm gonna go ahead and measure the center of the bottom, which if I had thought of it, I would have done it before. There I go. 11 and a half, so that's 5 3/4. One thing with this business, anything to do with window treatments, upholstery, slip covers, you are constantly using math. So when I was working with my granddaughter last week, I was having her figure out the math calculations, adding the seam allowances and stuff, and she actually did really good. And then we got into fractions, and she could even figure those out at 8 years old. So I was like, cool, we got you on the right path. All right, so that is my center. So my white diamond is my center. Make sure I've still got my up and down, and I did shift it a little bit. There we go. Check two or three times, make sure you get it in the right place, you don't have to take it apart. There, we got our first staple in. Now I'm gonna come in the back post. I don't know if you can see that easily. There you go. So the back post is right here. Maybe if I spin the chair. Yeah, that doesn't help. Oh, there we go, that way. So the back post is the center between the inside back, outside back and the outside arm, outside wing. So I want to make sure I'm not going too far over this way so that when we get ready to do the outside arm, I still have access to bring everything down here. And there is a sharp staple hanging out right there. It doesn't want to come in out, so we'll put it back in. Those are always the ones you cut your hand off on, and then you're all of a sudden bleeding everywhere. Alright. So I'm lining up the pattern so it meets the same point along the bottom of the frame. Do the same thing going this way. We may have to adjust those after, never know, but right now I think we're not going to have to, but we'll see. All right, so now I'm going to go ahead and pump the chair back up, and we're going to work on the top. I think this fabric's looking pretty snazzy. What do you guys think? I think it's also one of those that could make you very dizzy if you looked at it for too long. I definitely think doing it on the whole chair would have been a little bit too much, and I know, I think it was Kirk last week that said, that's a little wild, and I'm like, it is, but I'm loving it. Hello, Tony, and Jane says, happy Wednesday from the UK, and she loves using CurveEase. Yay! Michelle says, called PlyGrip in the UK. It's definitely a Marmite love-hate relationship. And you're right, it is called PlyGrip here, too. They call it both. I've gotten stuck on the CurveEase name, so that's what I always call it. And Susan Hartman says, she loves it, couldn't have done without it on a recent chair project. Edward said, I need tools, start small. Yeah, you definitely need the tools. And hello, Michelle, and I did get your email, and I'm sorry that you won't be able to join us for the meetup this year. And hello, Nancy, and Gina, and Sherry, and Sandra, and Molly, and Judy, and Rhonda. Rhonda is from Colorado, and she says, this chair is so fun. I'm working on two chairs with beautiful greenhouse fabrics. You'll have to share pictures of them in the community with us. And hello, Debbie and Annie. So, all right, let's go ahead and get some attaching going on down here. I just want to keep touching this chair. I really like this chair. Let's see, what do I need? I need a regulator. pair of scissors and chalk. Did I bring chalk over here? There's usually chalk in my pin dish, but of course there's not when I need it. Let's see. Yep, here's my chalk. I got it. So if you haven't done it yet and wouldn't mind, we would love it if you would please go ahead and share our Facebook feed and share on social media with YouTube as well. Let everybody else know what a fun project we're working on here on Facebook, and maybe they want to join in on the fun too. Alright, so this is my center diamond. Speak it this way, right there. You know what? I actually need my pins. Where are they? There they are. I love these upholsterer's pins. Which camera am I on? This one. I love these upholsterer's pins. They are great to have, and I like them because they've got such big ends that they're easy to hang onto, and they're also long, which makes them nicer to work with. What, Bill?
Is it a problem for you to turn to this camera?
Turn to which camera?
This one.
This one. There you go. All right. So we'll use this to anchor the fabric down. Actually, do you need me higher? No, it doesn't go any higher. Okay. Because you're missing the top of the chair. Oh, he's got it. The man behind the camera's got it. I should have known that. Alright, so anyway, so I use these to kind of hold it into position while I mark my curvies and trim it down. But let me just double check my center because I am anal with that stuff, so I check things over and over and over again. And still sometimes they come off wrong, come out wrong and I have to change them, but that's just kind of what happens. It's like when you're cutting fabric. Especially depending on the fabric I'm working with. Some fabrics I'll just like go at and cut with no problem. When you're working with large repeats or I'm working with very expensive fabric, I tend to measure like two or three times. Just because. In fact, last night, I forget what I was doing, Bill. Do you remember what I was doing? I was cutting something.
We were out there.
Oh, I was cutting the fabric out for this. That's what it was. We're out there and him and I are chatting away and I'm marking the fabric and I'm measuring and I looked up and I'm like, yep. And I started cutting it. That's the wrong mark. But luckily I didn't go too far and I was able to save it. Phew. It was close though. If I had gone like another 5 inches, we'd have been saying, well, we can't do the rest of the show because I gotta order more fabric. Into the cording. And that's hard for you to tell because my cotton's peeking out over here. We'll have to fix that after. So I'm just actually sticking my pins right into the cording that's around the top edge here. Oh, you know what? I had that one staple that I goofed on. I did not go back and take out. Where was it? I think it was right there and it's actually pushed my curvies down. So let me do that before I cause myself problems. The gun slipped when I was stapling it and it went right into the edge of the curvies and I think it closed it up a hair. And it's also buried in the cotton, so. Where are you? There you are. And it definitely closed that curvies right up. If we can lift it up with the oh, you know what? I'm gonna lift it up with a regulator. That's what I want. There. All better. Okay, so now I'll just get myself a fun ball. Chalk. And obviously the chalk's not going to show up really well on the white section, but you will still see it. And if a pin's in your way, sometimes you have to shift it. It shows up really well on the black. Now you can start tucking your curvies without doing the chalking and the trimming, but I find I get better results if I do it this way. There's a lot of different ways to do it. Just come up over here. Come up over there. Now we'll go ahead and trim this down. You don't lose your chop cam because you got two more sides with curvies to do. And I tend to err on the side of a little long rather than going too short because I can always cut more off, but I can't put it back on once I've cut it off. Getting accurate measurements and accurate cuts in your fabric are really critical when you're doing a lot of these projects. And I think that's oftentimes where mistakes happen, is if you didn't take the time, the extra time to square up your fabric, you don't need that, before you get started, and then you end up having it, you get it to your chair, and now you're trying to get the grain straight on your piece of furniture that you're working on, and because you didn't cut it straight of grain in the beginning, you didn't square your edge, then you go to straighten it, and now you're 2 inches short in one section. And that's another reason to, I'd rather overcut my pieces than cut them really exact and end up with a situation where now instead of wasting 4 inches, I've wasted a whole cut. So Jane says, hi Michelle, where are you based in the UK? She's in Hampshire between Andover and Salisbury. Hey, maybe you guys can hook up. All right, so we've got it trimmed. These are my tails on the end that are just my excess fabric that I always leave the excess there just in case I've shifted or something. All right, so now we should be able to go ahead and start tucking this, and I need a mallet. I use a wooden mallet with one end covered with fabric. I like the fabric being there because it's softer, it doesn't damage my fabric that I'm hitting on. You can also, I've seen people use rubber mallets, so rubber mallet works fine as well. This is just what I've always used. All right, double check my center. And I'm going to start right in the middle. I'm going to have to trim some of this, I think. And like I said, we're not going all the way to the edges. I'm just going part way, getting it held in here. I'm not going to mallet this part down yet, actually, just in case I need to adjust something once we get going on the arms. Actually, I'm going to move over here because I'm probably doing it towards me rather than working away from me. Alright, so I think about as far as I'm going to go. And if you close your curvies and need to adjust, you can reopen it using the flat end of your regulator or anything else that you can get in there to pry it. All right, so that'll hold that in place. We've got the bottom attached. Now I can flip this out of the way, go ahead and get our sides, our arms and wing area started, and then line the fabric up. So let's go ahead and do that. I'll move this around. See which way do I want to go first? Why don't we just roll it that way? Let's make sure nothing's in my way. Oh, there is, of course, all my tools are still over there. You want to help me, Bill, just so I don't totally crush my curvies?
Sure.
So we're just going to lay it on its side, and I actually am probably going to need something to keep it from rolling on me. You know what, spin it so it's straight on the, no, you go, yeah, I think, or that's a long way. I see what's happening, the whole thing's turning on me.
Yes, you're definitely going to
need
something
like a roll of jute webbing or rubber webbing or something. I'll lower this down while he's getting there. I think there's a bigger roll over there. Yeah, that's the other thing, is oftentimes you have to wedge things to keep your chairs from rolling if they're round, like this one is. Perfect, thank you. Alright, so let's see if I can get myself positioned in the camera right for you guys. Slide it. Do you want me to slide the chair towards the camera, Bill, towards the computer?
Pull the whole base.
That way?
You need to pull it.
Okay. We'll get it positioned here for you guys in a second. Let's just, there we go, how's that? All right, so now I'm gonna just flip this back for a moment. Get my outside arm fabric, and again, everything is marked. And up arrows. Let's see, where's my up? Yep, there we go. And remember, this is doing the wing too, so there's definitely some waste on here that we'll cut out, and maybe I'll make a pillow out of later. So we started with partial diamonds at the bottom, or full diamonds at the bottom. With the left to right is what we're going to be working on here to get these two to line up in a position that's pleasing to the eye. Where's my upright post? It's way back here. To make sure that I'm not leaving myself short here at the top either. Okay, upright post is not quite halfway through a diamond, a little bit more than halfway actually. All right, so see, you guys can't see that from here. Yeah, there's no way to get you to be able to see what I'm doing right here because of the angles of everything. So what I'm trying to do is get the diamonds to land so that they make sense in proportion of the back. And like I said, because of the angle of everything, it's just not gonna work everywhere. What if I turn over here for a second, Bill, and you put the front camera on? Let's try that. Yeah, there you go. Now you can really see what I'm working on. So I obviously don't want it to look like that. I mean, that just doesn't look good at all. So I've got to get this so that they line up in a place that makes the most sense. They're not going to line up all the way to the top. Down here at the bottom, where I've got the diamonds placed here, I think it's a good starting point. And then, like I said, I was looking for like right in this area down to be my best match. But as I'm looking at this, and this is definitely the parts when you're upholstering that take time, and you just have to be patient with it and work with it. You don't want to rush through this and then be like, ugh, if I tweaked it a half an inch, it would have worked. So it looks good here on the bottom. If I bring this up, so this is in the same place on the bottom. What's happening to our sides is not pretty. So, okay, this one, this isn't too bad. It's starting to squeak, so I think if I pull, I gotta also make sure, I did cut this extra wide, I gotta also make sure I got plenty in the front when I'm doing this. I think I overpulled. Don't forget, this is an angle back here too. Darn diamonds. I'm just constantly feeling for where that fold line is for my outside back. Which way do I want to go? If I go that way, you know, that's better because at least the black is within the black in some places, but then in others it's not so nice. And if I shift it up, then I'm going to lose my pattern along the bottom, which actually I just did. So this is where you kind of stand back and you say, okay, what's the best part to have looking the best? Let me see, I need my pin dish here. I think I'm going to need to stick some pins into it and then just kind of stand back. Bill's making faces too. No? Where's my little I'm going to flip this up just for a second. If I get this folded. This fabric anyway. What was I thinking? And sometimes you get to this point in your project and you're like, oh, I wish I hadn't picked that because this is just not fun. All right, so there is where I'm going to go for the fold. So I'm going to go ahead and pin this. Just so that I get the line all the way up instead of fighting with it. And you can see already as I creep up, you know, you've got no little diamonds showing here, then the diamond is almost complete, and then you get a little bit of the diamond starting to creep in. So you can see what the angle is doing to the pattern. And sometimes you get these situations and you need to get just so far and then just walk away and come back, because sometimes like the clear head later will do it, but obviously we gotta do this. So. There's no clearing your head this time, Kim. All right, so that gives me my pattern. And you know what the real fun part is? We get to do this again on the next side.
Might not be so lucky over there because you can't.
Well, that's why I started with the back, so I'm hoping that symmetrically, that's why I started with the back and in the center of a diamond. The best laid plans don't always come out as you think, though. So. And the pressure's on. Let's see if we can get this to work. All right, my instinct is to go with the bottom being straight all the way across, but as I come around the corner, this does shift down, so I'm not sure how critical that is. Do this. Force it up. Right, that looks straight up and down if I do that. So I think I'm actually going to put a couple temporary staples in this bottom to hold it. No, actually, I don't want to do that because I'm going to shift it left to right. Forget that idea. Yeah, because it's just, as I look at it, I want to squeak it up there, but then I want to not leave that line. So let's see what it looks like before we get up the chair. Maybe the top of the chair is more important than the bottom. So if I pull this way so that I get my diamond match up here. It might not be too bad. Let's do this a little bit further. All right, so what I'm looking at now is this one combination of diamonds right here and trying to get it so that little white blob makes sense here. Should be like right there. And this is a perfect example of how pattern match can take a ton of time. And this is one reason why when I do the beginner upholstery classes, I strongly suggest that people don't bring in large pattern matches, because you're not concentrating on the processes and the skills that you're trying to learn to upholster. You're so busy trying to figure out this pattern match that the rest of it just sometimes goes. So that one matches up there. So then you see it starts to come off. Now we've got two white diamonds, which doesn't look horrible. Then we end up with a little black diamond. Then we end up with a not so attractive. And then we kind of come back into not looking too bad again.
You can't change the angle of the fabric on the top. Are you trying to follow the line of the bottom of the chair?
That's what I was trying to do, and I'm not sure that's the right decision yet.
I wonder what it'll look like, because it's going to look...
It's going to look funky anyway because of the design, right? Yeah.
So if you change the angle a little bit, I wonder what would happen.
Alright, so that's option number one.
So that it would follow more in line with, if you drew a line straight up.
Straight up from where, Bill?
Straight up from the bottom.
From here?
No, on the bottom. Straight up from the bottom of the chair, put your left arm on top of the webbing. Straight up from there, following the line of one of the checks.
Right, that's what that's...
So then you need to move that to match up with it.
Oh, I see what you're saying. So forget this.
Yeah, the angle
this.
Changes because you're following the bottom of the chair.
Gotcha. All right, so let's see. I'm going to stick a temporary pin right there. So what Bill's saying to do is shift this.
Yeah, you need to pull it up. Yeah, there you go. That's a lot closer. Probably needs to go further.
And then just don't look at what this is doing.
Don't worry about the bottom there, maybe.
I'm not sure. This is a tough one. Yeah, because now this, so what he's saying is follow the center of the stripe this way. What do you guys think? More, but then look at this.
I know, that's what's going to happen.
All right. I'm having a hard time with this.
Well, so where do you want to see the fabric looking back?
Well, that's
it's not
going
to look good everywhere, so
yeah.
Where do you want to see?
This is a tough one. You guys can't see what he's seeing from over there. So what we're trying to do is to get this white diamond to be a continuous straight stripe all the way around. And when we do that, then over here on the side, I've got almost at the joint between the black and white where they meet. And then over here, it's completely shifted downhill. So it's in a totally different place. So this way, it still looks fairly straight to me though, I think. Definitely going to be seeing all kinds of crazy things. So can you guys see this that well? I'm looking at what you guys see on camera. So see what's happening to the bottom over here? How the starting out black and then the black's creeping up? Which it's definitely a wild chair. So it's like, what matters more, having this be in a straight line or having this intersection look more copaesthetic? So somebody says it's matching. Rhonda says, whoops, what'd she say about Bill's comment?
Let me get situated.
Okay. So let me see what this side's doing when we do that. And it's bringing this way. And I can always change the fold a little bit on this and hand stitch it shut, too, to get a more pleasing. So then if we leave that there, I pull this down. Now that at the top doesn't match, but it matches more at the bottom. Or not matches, but looks more pleasing. What are you guys thinking so far? Can you see over my head here? So let's see, yes, it looks good, it's matching. I think Bill's idea is good. So let's see, I'm looking and seeing how it looks on camera from you guys' angle versus me in person, because sometimes when you're too close, it's just kind of like all over. Yeah, this fabric definitely makes your eyes jump. I can see all kinds of things happening with the pattern now. So let's see, Kim, what do you want to do? My other option would be to, like I said, readjust the fold on here and hand stitch the back shut and make it look better if possible, but it's, like I said, it's never going to be perfect. I don't know, I'm struggling with matching at the top, letting the bottom go crazy, or matching at the bottom and letting this top section go crazy.
How about you either pin that or get a temporary staple, stand the chair up and you can spin it around and look at it.
Okay. Yeah, that might be helpful. I'm glad I didn't get a bigger diamond. That would have really been crazy. Which originally I was going to. Phew! Thank goodness I didn't. And I think it's also, it's like, gonna be one of those. Either it's gonna like stand out and go, oh my God, that's just not gonna work. Or it's gonna be a personal that some people are gonna go, oh, that looks fine. And other people are gonna go, ooh, what were you thinking? All right, I think it's anchored enough. So, there you go, okay? So just stand it up and then we'll spin it. Thank you, camera guy. All right, are you guys ready? I'm looking at it on camera so I can see what you guys see rather than me being on top of it. And that doesn't look horrid, does it? But boy, does it play with your eyeballs.
How's it look around the side of it?
Yeah, I'm just going to put some temporary staples up here just to hold this up so we can get a visual. Whoops. Yeah, I can't put them in the right place. That one's not in the right place. And I put one in totally the wrong side, so don't look at that one. So I pull this up there. What do you guys think of that on the front, or on the side? So how the black diamond climbs up and it becomes white when you get towards, or up here towards the front.
I like that better.
I think I do too.
Yeah.
I didn't think I was going to. Okay, so what's everybody's thumbs up if you like it the way we get it? Yeah, it's not horrid. It definitely is going to drive your eyes a little bonkers. Any comments yet, Bill? And don't forget you're going to have the blue peeking out of here, which is going to give your eye a little bit of rest.
Let's see. Actually, there's a lot of comments you have to go through with this.
Okay. Hey, Kirk. Now, Kirk, you can see this chair really is wild. You were right when you made that comment last week. It's definitely wild. Hello, Troy and Deanna. Deanna says, I've used a flip-flop to wedge a chair from rolling. Good morning from Greenwood, says James, and hello, Amy. And Lee says, hi, I close all sides without trimming the fabric then. When I'm happy with the fit, open it up and put it back in. Yep, there's so many different ways to use CurveEase. Patterns can be tricky. This is great to see how you figure this chair. Note to self, don't upholster with diamonds. Yeah, I think I'm on that with you, definitely. Are you going to hand stitch the side? Sometimes you can tweak better with hand stitching. Yeah, I did mention that probably after your post, that hand tweaking or hand stitching might be what I do. I stepped away and came back looking good. That's hard. That looks hard. Yeah, it's definitely going to be hard, but it looks good. Okay, thank you. And it's matching. I think Bill's idea is good. Do you have to keep the outside back straight up and down? Can you widen the outside back to fit the outside arms? I did think of that too. I'm widening the outside back, but I think I've already committed to not doing that with the way I cut my fabric. Back looks good, just adjust that back row 5 to 4. That's Lisa. Bonnie says, like you tell us, you'll have to let it go. Yeah, sometimes you do have to let it go, Bonnie, you are right. Can you change the back outside fold to narrow at the top and wider at the bottom? I was kind of thinking of that, and I don't think it's going to help. I think the join in the back is more visible than the bottom edge. Okay, that was Rhonda. Can you measure that white diamond on both sides from the ground up to make sure it is level? That's a good idea. Deanna says, looks great. Sandra says, I'm thinking that Sylvia said bring the back down and angle widen the back panel to match. So widen at the bottom, you guys are talking about, I assume. I would hand stitch this for sure. Yeah, I definitely think after doing what I've done so far that hand stitching is going to be what's happening. Sylvia's answering somebody else, I think. Bottom match, somebody's saying. Bonnie says, I agree. Little adjustment at the back halfway up. I don't know if we've already made that or not. Sorry. Looks good. Thumbs up. I liked it better with the black diamonds even along the bottom. And hello, Kathy and Alan. Welcome to our crazy decisions with diamonds. Anybody on YouTube chiming in? Let's see.
Yep.
Okay. And it's like these are going sideways to me now, which is going to bug me. So let's see. Kim says, thanks for your great work. I've learned a lot. And then Debbie says, from Charlotte, South Carolina, just reupholstered a wingback chair starting on my second. Yes, it is addicting. Never reupholstered before. Always made slipcovers. Thanks for your great lessons. Maria says, miss it. Yes, keep the white straight. Debbie says, I ran into a similar situation myself. As long as you can make it the same on each side, which is the trick, I think it might work. And then Wayne and Kim say, I like how the diamonds start out smaller at the bottom and then get wider at the top. Carolyn says, if the back of the chair faces a wall, wouldn't it be best to make the sides look even?
If we put it in a corner.
Yeah, we could hide it in the corner and nobody'd see it, right? And then Maria says, thanks, Bill. This is what I was thinking. And then Debbie says, I love the pattern of the fabric. Seen anything like it. Smart idea. Debbie says, once it's in the room, it's going to look fabulous. And yes, I think the diamonds even across the bottom looks better. Okay, so we got votes in both ways here, and I am really undecided. I am not sure, and I don't want to commit yet. Because if this is even on the bottom, this visually looks straight, but now this looks like it's going that way to me.
Well, right now it's almost 25 after.
Oh, okay.
So that gives you plenty of time off camera
to figure this out. Yeah, yeah. I'm looking at the camera view that you guys see on the screen, and I'm not sure. What do you guys think of this?
This is a first. Kim,
yeah,
I'm kind of stumped.
Yeah, I've never had one that's given me this much trouble. And I, like I said, sometimes you need to just walk away and come back, and all of a sudden it will click.
Damn, but Bill had to have diamonds.
Yeah, the diamonds were Bill's idea, guys. Let's blame him. Yeah, I definitely think I need to play with it some more. I think hand stitching is going to be key. Let's just quickly try the suggestions that we get to widen this at the bottom, but I'm still thinking I'm going to bring that down some. So if we widen this out, you know, I might even have enough up here to incorporate that in the wing. And have the two maybe connect up here, not have the arm as wide. So if I angle it, where's my wing piece? It's right there. Yeah. It's gonna look better in some places and worse in others. I think it's one of those things that I'll fix one part and another part's gonna go crazy on me. So I really do think this is gonna be one of those that I need to walk away and come back later. Oh, before we end our show, I have to tell you guys, we have our upholstery meetup coming up, which I know most of you know about. I was contacted by Valdez Weavers, who is the third largest mill in the world, and they have asked our meetup group to tour their facility when we do our meetup in Gastonia, North Carolina this summer. So I am like so thrilled and hope some of you will join in on us. This is going to be an awesome tour. None of us can wear sandals. We have to wear closed-toed shoes, but they reached out to me yesterday and we made it work. So we are adding a fourth vendor to our tour for the upholstery meetup. And I can't wait to go. And they get tons of fabrics for us to look at too. And they do have trade accounts so people can sign up for accounts. Before or while we're there. So, all right, guys. So I think I am going to, it's a couple minutes early here, unless anybody has any questions before we let you go. I am going to like drive myself crazy with diamonds for a while. Drop the side first, then wind the back. Yes, good point, Sandra, you are right. Let's see. There was one that jumped. Excited about the meetup. Joan says, it keeps bouncing. You guys are commenting. Every time you do it, shifts on me. Rhonda's excited for the meetup as well. Bill's trying to find the questions for me. I don't see any popping in. Everybody's just making good comments.
Yeah, so. I was jumping around a bit.
So. Yeah, shift to the side. I think Bonnie said she thought was good too. But yeah, I think this being not straight up and down is going to drive me cuckoo more than back here. So I think first what I'll do is get this straight, and then I'll play with Sylvia and Sandra's suggestion of widening. What?
I think a glass of wine would do a lot of good to try and figure this out.
It's too early in the day for a glass of wine.
Today's special.
Today's special because of this, yeah. There you go. Glass of white wine, so we don't spill red wine on our chair. But maybe just a cup of coffee. But anyway, thank you guys for joining us here today. And if you are interested in going to our upholstery meetup, if you go to our kimsupholstery.com website, look under the resources tab, find Upholstery Meetup 2019. You can read all about it and register there. There's no cost to you except for your expenses while you're there if you do food and lodging. So for our meetup, I'll give you a quick rundown on what the itinerary is. My tongue's getting twisted here. Day one is Wednesday, July 31st. We are going to Revolution Fabrics in the morning for a tour that'll probably be about an hour and a half to 2 hours long. And then the afternoon is open. We've got a side group who has decided to go see Greenhouse Fabrics in the afternoon. So we've got somebody setting that up. Some of us went last year. And then Wednesday evening, I'm holding a reception cocktail party, and we have Greenhouse Fabrics, Crest Leather, and Reupholstery Charlotte coming in to do a little bit of a presentation, as well as the vice president of the newly formed National Upholsterers Association. She will be there, her and Rhonda, who is on here chatting with us, will be there telling you about the association and what our plans are for the association. I'm excited to be on the board of directors for that. And then on Thursday, we will be going to Krypton Fabrics in the morning for, again, another hour and a half tour. And then from there, we'll all go have lunch and then gather at Valdez Weavers for a tour of their facility. And they're going to break us into two groups for most of these because we have almost 70 people signed up. So they are going to break us into smaller groups. So we'll be going through at different points, we'll be in different areas. And then on Friday, we're going to Rolly Company in the morning to hear all about the products that they carry that are upholstery related. And I've put a bug in their ear hoping that they'll add Sagless to their list because I know some of you struggle finding that. So I am really excited about the tours that we have planned. There's also a few fabric stores in the area because even though we're seeing fabric, you want to see more fabric, right? So I hope some more of you will join us for this event. And thank you for joining us here today for the live. And I'll post pictures as I figure out what the heck I'm going to do with my diamond patterns and where I'm going to match what. So again, thanks. And I will be headed off to New York this weekend. I'm leaving tomorrow. Oh, and I'm touring. I'm going for a tour of Albany Foam on my way through there en route. So I called them and they are up for having me come for a visit. So look for lots of pictures of our upholstery workshop that's coming up and the visit to Albany Foam. So thanks again, everybody, and have a great weekend. I think I need new glasses after looking at these. Whew.